We're so glad that each of you could be here with us this morning. Would you stand with us? I know we have a lot of families that are missing this morning. We're so thankful that you could be here. Let's pray together as we get ready to worship this morning. Lord, we love you. Jesus, we thank you that we have the opportunity to worship you this morning. God, we thank you for our health. We thank you, Lord, for the freedom that we have to gather together and praise your name. Lord, we want to honor you. We want to glorify you. So have your way in this place. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And God, we are here to meet with you this morning. So have your way in this place, God. We love you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship him this morning. Who am I that the highest King will welcome me?
I was lost, but he brought me his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
You. Jesus I've seen in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. So be close, listen, let's surround me and breathe. Draw me to your side. And as I wait, I rise up like the eagle. And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love. Lord, open my eyes, let me see you face to face, the knowledge of your love as you live in me. The Lord, renew my mind as you will unfold in my by the power of your love. So be close, oh, be close. Let's surround me. Bring me near. Draw me to your side. And I'll rest in black and blue. Now I'm so with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love. So be close, let your love surround. Draw me to your side. Oh, 'cause as I wait, I rise up like the eagle. And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love. And I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle. And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love. Jesus, there's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus, no sweeter name than I've ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than I've ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the light of my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness round me. You are the hope to hopeless and broken. You are the only truth in the way. 'Cause no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. Jesus, no sweeter name than I've ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the light of my heart, my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to hopeless and broken. You are the only truth everywhere. You are the light to my heart, my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to hopeless and broken. You are the only truth everywhere. 'Cause you are the light to my heart and my soul. You are the light to, 'cause you are the hope to the hopeless and broken. You are the only truth in the way. Jesus' name, you're the way. 'Cause you're the way. Let's just sing that one more time. You are the light. You are the light to my heart and my soul. You are the light to darkness around me. You are the hope to hopeless and broken. You are the only truth and the way. Jesus' name, the truth and the way.
To be happy, yeah.
It's just and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And praise the Lord. God, we make that our prayer today. Lord, that's the desire of our hearts today as your church. God, to worship you, to love you, to trust you. Just that obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Seated above, enthralled in the Father's love, he's destined to die and poured out for all mankind. He's God's only Son, his perfect and spotless one. Does he never sin? He suffered as if he did. He's our authority. He's every victory. It's just. He's our authority. He's every victory. Speaking the Father's plan, sending us out, light in this broken land. Oh, power in hand, speaking the Father's plan. It's you are sending us out, light.
Awesome and powerful forever.
awesome and great is your name. You of kings. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit's like water to my soul. Your word is the lamp unto my feet. And Jesus, I love you. I love you, 'cause your name is like honey on my lips. Spirit's like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp to my feet. Jesus, I love you. I love you. Come on, say that. Jesus, I love you, Jesus, I love you, I love you, and Jesus, I love you, I love you. On my lips, your spirit's like water to my soul. Word is a lamp to my feet. And Jesus, I love you. I love you. Make that your prayer. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit is like water to my soul. Word is a lamp unto my feet. And Jesus, I love you. I love you. And Lord, I want to yearn for you. I want to burn with passion over you. And only
Church, I don't know about you. I don't know where you're at today, but I know that I feel like I need the Spirit to be water to my soul today. You know, there's just times in life where we're just tired, where sometimes we're just dry, and we just need the Holy Spirit just to refresh our souls. And I love that this song just paints these great word pictures for us. His name is like honey on our lips, and his spirit is water. It's life to our soul, church. Some of you might be here today and you are tired and you are weary and you are run down and you just need water in your soul. You just need to be refreshed by the power of the Holy Spirit. I know we have many that aren't here today that have called us and texted us that are sick, and they just need the touch of God today. So I'm just going to ask you, if you're comfortable, just close your eyes, just raise your hands to heaven. And we're just going to ask Holy Spirit this morning just to refresh our souls. Lord Jesus, we are so thankful for you. We're thankful that we can be here together in your presence. And God, you are here to meet with us. We're not just singing songs. We're not just gathering on a Sunday to check up our list, but we have come to meet with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Holy Spirit, you are here with us, and we are asking that you would meet every need today, that you would refresh every soul, that you would begin to heal the bodies that are sick, that are here and not here. Whether you are in this place, you are online with us, or you are at home today, and you've sent us a text message and said, I can't be here because I'm sick in body. Lord, we're just asking for your touch today. Lord, we're asking that you would meet our needs, that God, if there's some of us here today, we're just in chaos and turmoil, that Holy Spirit, you would comfort, you would give us peace. I pray today if we're sick in body, then from the top of our head to the soles of our feet, you would begin to heal us. Lord, if we're lacking peace in our hearts, and God, I just pray that you would come. Oh, Prince of Peace, that you would just begin to give us the peace that surpasses all understanding, that guards our heart and guards our mind for those that are in Christ Jesus today. Lord, if we are lacking wisdom, we are asking for your direction, that your word would be, like it says, a lamp and a guide. Today we need your guidance. Today we need the light shine in the dark places. Lord Jesus, we love you. Oh, we worship you. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our affection. You are worthy of our adoration. And Lord, we're so thankful for you. We're thankful for the gift that you are, that you've given us life, salvation, forgiveness, love that's unconditional. And today we just turn our eyes to you. We set our attention on you. Holy Spirit, have your way in this service today. Help our ears to be opened, our hearts to be ready, and our feet just anxious to respond to you. Speak to us today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, I'm really excited to get to share this morning. I'm going to continue in Joshua, where Pastor Billy left off. We're going to be turning in our Bibles to Joshua chapter 2. If you have your Bible with you, you can go ahead and get ready and head there. As I was getting ready to preach this morning, Joshua chapter 2 is about Rahab, and I found out apparently a lot of pastors don't particularly like to preach about Rahab. But I love the story of Rahab, and I'm going to tell you why. Because this chapter reads to me like Mission Impossible. This is full of spies and armies, and there's even a prostitute. Oh, I thought that was a lot funnier than you guys did, I guess. I was totally cracking myself up. I mean, seriously, think about it. It would be like the perfect Hollywood movie, right? I mean, God is really cool. He puts crazy stuff in the Bible that we're like, ooh, we're going to skip over that. Ooh, we don't need to read that to the kids. That's a little touchy. Okay, I'm going to go there this morning, okay? So you're going to go there with me because it's in the Bible, all right? Here we go.
So when we start Joshua chapter 2, we find Joshua, he's been studying the Bible, right? He's been studying the law. He's been in God's word. And now he's following God's leading and his direction. And he's taking a step of faith that God is going to give them the land that he has promised. So starting in verse 1, it says, "And Joshua the son of Nun sent two men secretly as spies, saying, 'Go view the land, especially Jericho.'" So there's something that's very interesting to me already here. It says he sent the spies out secretly. That tells me a couple of things. It tells me, number one, I don't think that he realized even then what God was going to do. I think that his plan was, we're going to have to take this place by force. So you guys need to go scout it out. There's another thing that's interesting. If you remember all the way back when Moses had led the Israelites and they were supposed to be going into Canaan, he sent a whole bunch of spies, right? And there was only two that came back with a good report. The rest of them were like, "No way, Jose, this is never going to happen." So I have a feeling Joshua learned from that experience and was like, "I'm just sending two." So now 40 years later, Joshua chooses those two spies to send in and scout the land that God has given them. So we continue on. It says, "And they went and came to the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there." Now, they weren't going there for business, okay? They were going there because Rahab's house was the perfect place to stay, all right? Her house was like, right as soon as you come in the front gate, right? This was a popular place back in the day to go. The men would come in, and that was like the first stop. So she had primo location. Not only that, but the Bible says her home was built into the wall. So the wall was actually double layered, okay? It was like around 12 feet distance in between so that houses could be built in the wall. So her house was primo location with a primo view, right? She didn't just see inside the city. She could see outside the walls. She had a great place. And it was also really easy for them to stop there and kind of hide there because there was constantly people coming in and out. All right? Miss Joanne is going to lose it with me talking about this topic. But it was a really great location. It was a really great place for them to be just kind of faceless in the crowd. But God had sovereignly led them to the one person in all of Jericho who believed in him. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm one of the spies, I'm not assuming that the one person in all of Jericho who believes in Jesus is the prostitute on the corner. I'm not looking for her in the red light district. That would not be my go-to place. And yet that is the one person in all of Jericho who believed. We go on and read, it says, "And it was told to the kings of Jericho, 'Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land.' Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land.' But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, 'True, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from.' And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. 'I don't know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them.'" So listen, I want to insert something here. Lying is never justifiable. God did not need Rahab to lie to protect the spies, okay? But in this case, she believed, but her faith, her belief was still very immature, okay? So it's understandable. Remember Joshua 1:9, it said, "For the Lord is with you wherever you go." So those spies, they were covered by the Lord. They didn't need her to lie, but she did. And, you know, I've been wondering why did the king's guard believe her so easily? I mean, if that's me and I'm coming to your house like, "Hey, there were people that said these guys are in your home." And she's like, "Oh, no, they were here, but they left." I'm still searching that home. But there's a couple things I've thought of. Number one, as her profession back in that day and where she was, it was actually a highly respectable position, okay? It wasn't like how we would think of prostitutes these days. She had a prominent position. Even sometimes they were priestesses in this religion. It was a pagan religion, okay? So just her position in and of itself lent her to being trustworthy to them. There's also clearly, there was fear involved, right? She's, oh no, if you run right now, if you go really quick, you can catch him. There was fear involved. You know, the people were scared. They went to the king and said, hey, there's these people. They're here. They're spying things out. They went to the king like right away, right? He automatically sends his guard. So the king is scared. He sends him. Go get him. Let's get him. The guard is scared. They're running all over the place like chickens with their head cut off trying to find this guy, these guys, right? So there was fear. Let's keep reading. Verse 8 says, before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan. So Sihon and Gog, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and the earth beneath. Listen, church, like Rahab, we need to choose faith over fear. Rahab is telling us, you know, she's heard all of these stories of all the things that God has done for the Israelite people. She's heard it because everyone in Jericho has heard it. The difference between her and everybody else in Jericho was she chose to have faith in the stories she had heard instead of fear. All of those stories, the stories of how Jesus had, how God had parted the Red Sea, right, about how he had destroyed the Amorite kings, these were big things that they had heard about, and they had been living in fear, but not Rahab. This woman who was raised in a pagan land with a pagan religion by pagan parents, she heard the same stories everyone else in Jericho did, but she heard and she believed. She was, while everybody else was putting their faith in the army and the walls surrounding them, she was putting her faith in God. A God she had barely even heard about. Hebrews 11:31 says, by faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. You know, we've been talking about the difference between believing and having faith, and Pastor Billy has said faith is action. Faith led her to welcome the spies and to protect them. Faith leads us to be bold and courageous. Verse 12 says, now then, please swear to me by the Lord, as I have dealt kindly with you, you will also deal kindly with my father's house, and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. And the men said to her, our life for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us this land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you. Skip down to verse 15, it says, then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall, so that she lived in the wall. So once again, Rahab is displaying faith. Talk about a woman who is bold and courageous, right? She is choosing not the kingdom that she grew up in. She's choosing not to identify with the culture that's surrounding her, but she's choosing instead to recognize and rely upon the kingdom of the one true God. She's stronger with God than she is with every soldier or with the strongest wall that's surrounding her, right? And she said, according to your words, so be it. So she sent them away and they departed. And she tied the scarlet cord in the window. God can use our mess for his glory, church. Verse 24 says, the spies go back and they go back to Joshua and they say, truly the Lord has given all the land into our hands and also all the inhabitants of the land melt because of us. Listen, this time they go back and the spies report, listen, they have heard about everything God's been doing for us. There is no reason we cannot take them. They are terrified of us. You know, the Israelites screwed up big time. They messed up in a major way. God had led them to the promised land before and said, go take the land. And they were too stinking chicken. They were. Bok, bok. They messed up in a royal way, and yet God took it and he used it. Because during the 40 years that they were out wandering in the wilderness, he was getting the word around of all the great things that he had done. So by the time the spies went in the next time, everybody there, they weren't talking about, oh, there's giants in the land. No, it was, dude, they are terrified. They are scared. They're shaking in their boots. He uses it. He uses even our failures for his glory when we turn to him and act in obedience. See, if they hadn't have gone back in, if he hadn't have sent those spies back in, then that all of that good stuff that God had been doing, it wouldn't have been really put to use, right? If they would have just sat outside the city, well, you know, you still got to be obedient. You still have to act in obedience. But because he sent the spies in, they got to find out, oh, look, God's been using the stupid stuff we did for his glory. Their obedience brought that about. Now this prostitute has heard, and she's heard it enough, and she's pondered it enough, that she has grown to believe, and she's got faith in God. You know, there's so much more to this story about the wall coming down, but that isn't where I want to focus today, mostly because that's a whole other sermon or two. I want to focus on Rahab. Spoiler alert, though, the walls do come down, right? Not by the might of the Israelite army, but by the Spirit of God. The Israelites never even have to unsheath a single sword or notch a single arrow or catapult a single projectile, right? It's their obedience and a shout of praise that bring the walls down, all except a small portion of the wall that is Rahab's house. That house with the red cord tied to the window where the spies had fled from just days prior. I had never thought about the fact that there would still have to be a little piece of that wall still standing. I've always just thought of the whole thing crumbling, and it did. Everything crumbled around her. But if you go back and look, the spies said, stay in your house. If anyone goes out on the street, their blood is on their own head. They were to stay in the house, everything in the house, every family member, all their belongings were saved as long as they were in that house. And if the house was in the wall, a little piece of that wall had to stand. Can you imagine? Everything came crumbling down around her, but that red cord. That red cord saved her home, saved her family, her faith. Her courageous obedience saved them. Joshua 6:25 says, but Rahab the prostitute and her father's household and all who belonged to her, Joshua saved alive. And she has lived in Israel to this day because she hid the messengers whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. You know, when she was talking to the spies, she didn't say, swear by your God. She said, swear by God, the God. Swear by the God that you will deal kindly with me. She was saying, God, you oversee this contract between us. Not your God, the God. Her God. if Rahab had continued to live like she always had, if the culture and popular opinion around her could sway her, if she aligned herself with the kingdom that surrounded her, she would have suffered the same fate that the rest of them did. But instead, she chose to align herself with the kingdom of God. And some of you really need to hear me say this. Your past does not have to define your future. You can choose to align yourself instead with the kingdom of God. It's not about who you were before Christ. It's about who you are in Christ. Too many of you are living in condemnation, racked with guilt for things that happened in your life in the past instead of living free in Christ. I've already said it, but I'll say it again. God can use even the stupid, messed up things in your life to bring him glory. When we become surrendered and completely obedient to him. You know, you might think her story stops here, but it doesn't. God continues to use Rahab, the woman who used to be a prostitute. If you turn in Matthew chapter 1, there's the genealogy of Jesus. Now, most of you have probably just skipped over it. It's the begats, right? So-and-so begat so-and-so. It gets boring. But if you've skipped over it, you've missed some really cool things in the genealogy of Jesus. So stick with me for just a minute, because I want to help you learn something this morning. As a side note, Matthew follows the legal Jewish system in giving the genealogy of the father, even though Joseph was the father only by adoption. So Matthew's purpose in recording the genealogy of Jesus through that side was two ways: to demonstrate that Jesus had royal lineage through King David, right? But also to demonstrate his link with Abraham, who is the founder of the Jewish race. So here we go. Matthew goes on to list, starting with Abraham. Abraham, Isaac, Isaac, Jacob, Jacob, Judah, and Judah's brothers. Then we have Judah and Tamar. Okay, hold on a minute. We've been doing this thing on Wednesday nights where we look back and then we look forward surrounding a certain event. So this is one of those, let's look back. Judah and Tamar. If you don't know the story of Judah and Tamar, it's important, and I'll tell you why. Tamar was originally Judah's daughter-in-law, okay? Judah had her marry his oldest son first. The Bible says he was so wicked, God killed him. Boom, he was gone. So he takes Tamar and has her marry his second oldest son. God says the same thing. He was so wicked, boom, he murders him. So Tamar says, listen, I need to marry your last son. And he says, no hanging way. He's scared for his kid. So instead of doing what was right, instead of giving her a kinsman redeemer, instead of covering her, he tries to push her aside. Kind of tries to keep her quiet, keep her hidden. So she dresses as a prostitute and tricks him. And, well, one thing leads to another. And she says, how are you going to pay me? And he says, well, I'm going to leave here my signet cord and my staff. So she takes those things. Now, mind you, she's been covered. She's been hidden. He doesn't know who she is. He finds out later that his daughter-in-law, who's not currently married to anyone, is pregnant. And he wants to have her put to death. And she says, oh, no, here's your cord. And it saves her life. And the Bible says that he is immediately repentive. And he makes things right for her, makes things right with her. So Judah and Tamar together, they have twins, Perez and Zerah. Perez fathers Hezron, Hezron Ram, Ram Abinadab, Abinadab Nashon, Nashon Salmon. Now Salmon decides to marry a woman who was an actual prostitute. Her name was Rahab. And she's the second out of only four women listed in Jesus' lineage. Rahab was no spring chicken, y'all. She had been around the block a time or two. She had had more partners than you and I can probably imagine. And yet the Bible never lists that she ever had any children. So there's even a possibility that they could have thought maybe she's even barren. And yet Salmon looks at her with the eyes of Jesus and doesn't see the prostitute, doesn't see the broken woman.
He sees what God sees. He sees redeemed. He sees loving, beautiful, chosen. And he chooses her. And together, through their lineage, Boaz is born. If you all remember the story of Ruth and Boaz, it's really cool because, once again, Ruth is without a husband. But this time, unlike his ancestor, Boaz does the right thing and becomes kinsman redeemer to Ruth and covers Ruth and protects Ruth and shields Ruth. And through Boaz, God redeems what had happened before in their lineage and in their history. So you've got Tamar saved by the cord. You've got Rahab saved by the red cord. You've got Ruth saved by her kinsman redeemer. And y'all, then you have us saved by the red blood of our redeemer. That is something to be, I just want to clap. It's so good. It's so good how God shows us over and over and over throughout his word, his redemption plan, not just for Rahab, but for you and for me. Saved by the cord, saved by the red cord, saved by the kinsman redeemer, saved by the blood of the redeemer. So much better. They were saved individually and temporarily. They still had to have a relationship with the Lord, but you and I are saved because of our relationship with the Lord. That's an incredible thing. If you've ever felt like God is embarrassed of you because of your past, don't look any further than Rahab. God protected a prostitute who had faith. She's even listed in Hebrews 11 along with the heroes of faith. She's listed in Jesus' own genealogy. Listen, I don't know what your genealogy looks like, but no matter what your background is, no matter who raised you, how you were raised, what kind of life you have lived, God can save you and he can use you. Before Rahab had faith, while she was living a sinful, adulterous, idolatrous life, God went before her. He was providing a way for her. News of God's power, of all that he'd done, had reached her, and she believed. In the middle of her story, in the middle of her mess, she exercises her faith and she puts her trust in the Lord. She says, "Swear to me by the Lord." Not your Lord, our Lord, the Lord. She's strong and courageous, hiding the spies. She had to know if they were found in her home that she'd be killed right there along with them. And yet she was strong and courageous, and she steps out in faith. And after she turns from the pagan practices and puts her faith in the one true God, her faith in God and her courage save her. Her family members, her family's family members, and all of their belongings, all of her peeps were safe. Not only that, but God continues to use her. Maybe you can see yourself in Rahab's story. Each one of us was lost in sin at one time. But even then, God was preparing a way for us. He sent Jesus to die for you and for me. In the middle of your mess, Jesus wants to meet with you. He loved you when you were at your lowest point, and he loved you even in the middle of your sin and in the middle of your brokenness. Jesus loves you. Rewriting and redeeming are God's specialty. I'm going to say that again because I want you to really get it this morning. Rewriting and redeeming are God's specialty. God redeems the story of each and every person who puts their faith in Christ. Every person who says yes to the Lord, who says yes to serving God with unreserved passion. Tamar's life was saved by a cord. Rahab's life was saved by the red cord. Ruth's life was restored by her kinsman redeemer. But you and I, our lives have been purchased by the blood of our redeemer.
you can know that you're safe. And you can be strong and courageous knowing that the red blood of Jesus covers you. It protects you. It restores you. And because of it, God can use you. Now that you're covered in the blood, it's time to be strong and courageous. God wants to save you, yes, but he also wants to use you. You've probably heard us say God wants to do through you what he's done in you. Just like he used Rahab more than she could have possibly even realized during her lifetime. God has an amazing purpose for you, but if you get so caught up in the labels that have been placed on you, maybe it's not prostitute, but you know what that label is. Maybe it's labels you've earned. And listen, if you haven't already given yourself to Christ, if you haven't already made that decision to make Jesus Lord of your life and given him those things, then do that. But if you already have those labels, they don't define you anymore. Those don't belong on you anymore. When Jesus looks at you, when God looks at you, he doesn't see that label. He sees that red blood of the Redeemer that covers you. So you need to stop identifying by those labels and start identifying by whose blood you are covered in. If Rahab got caught up in the shame of who she used to be, she wouldn't have gone on to get married and been the wife and the mother that God created her to be. You know, condemnation is a lie of the enemy. Condemnation is a big word that just means guilt that doesn't belong there. Condemnation is a lie that the enemy uses to try to get us and hold us back from all that God has created us to do and created us to be. Condemnation sounds a lot like, oh, I'm not good enough. Oh, I'm not smart enough. Oh, Pastor, if you only knew the things that I had done in my life. Listen, God knows and he still wants to use you. If he could use a pagan prostitute, he can use you. I don't care what you've done, who you've been in your past, where you've come from. It does not matter because it doesn't matter who you've been. It matters who you are in Christ. As I was going over this, there were even some faces that came to my heart and my mind. Listen, I know that some of you live with walls. I know you live with walls. They're there for all sorts of different reasons. The people of Jericho thought that their walls would keep them safe. Maybe your walls feel like a security blanket. And the thought of having those walls come down and being exposed is scary. But the truth is, there's not an army or a wall strong enough. Only Jesus, only God that can protect you, that can cover you, that can save you. Y'all, your walls are not going to keep you safe. I know it feels like they might, but they're not. And Jesus wants to penetrate through some things today. There is no condemnation in Jesus. You don't have to carry your own weight of your past. You don't have to carry your spouse's weight. There is no condemnation in Jesus. I want you to do something with me this morning. Would you just stand with me? At one time in your life, each and every one of us, I can guarantee you, has struggled with condemnation of some kind. Because when we come to Jesus, we all of a sudden have this realization of, oh my gosh, I am messed up. Without Jesus, each and every one of us has a whole list of name tags that would be put on us. And we do need to take those things to Jesus, church. We do need to move on past those things. We do need to hand those things over to the Father. But once you do, you cannot stay there. Rahab didn't stay there. When the walls were falling all around her, that cord saved her. When everything feels like it's coming down on around you, the blood of your Redeemer saves you. You don't have to trust an army. You don't have to trust your walls. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? If that's you this morning and you would say, you know, I've been holding on to some stuff. I feel guilty. I don't quite know how to shake it. I know God loves me. I know he wants to use me. But every time I feel like something's just holding me up. Or maybe you've thought, and maybe you've even said out loud, oh, I'm good. I know God's got that. It's in my past. But in reality, it's still something that has your heart. If that's you this morning and you want to take a bold step of faith, a courageous step of faith to say, you know what, I'm going to leave those things behind. I'm going to leave those labels behind. I'm going to leave the condemnation and the guilt behind. And I'm going to choose today to give those things to Jesus and to walk in freedom. Because those things aren't holding me back anymore. If that's you, would you just raise your hand? Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that the moment that we step out of our past and into all that you have created us to be by saying yes to you, we no longer have to identify with our past. God, I ask that this morning you would begin to break down walls. Walls of insecurity, walls of anger, walls of hurt, walls of pain. Lord, break them down. Holy Spirit, for each and every person that feels the weight, Lord, that you would just begin to lift that weight even now, even as I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would go to each and every individual and that you would just remove that condemnation. Lord, remind them over and over again who they are in you. If that's you this morning and you've raised your hand, or maybe you haven't even raised your hand, but you know that's you, I want to ask you to do something this morning. Because listen, Rahab didn't just believe. She acted in her belief. She had faith, and she took a step out, and she did something that was scary. And, you know, it didn't really matter that she could have been killed because she was hiding the spies. She knew it was right, and she knew she wanted to follow Jesus, and so she took a step of faith. And so I want you to do something for me this morning. If that's you, and you want to leave that behind, just as an outward expression of what's going on in your heart, I want you to take a step with me towards this altar. Don't wait. Just come. Don't wait. Just come. Be strong and courageous. Be bold and courageous. Be bold and courageous. There's something that happens in our hearts when we take a step. When we move out of our own comfort zone and we say, God, I don't even care anymore. I just need you. I just want to respond to you. I just want to say yes. I know there's more, so I'm going to wait a minute. Bold and courageous, bold and courageous, strong and courageous. He's with you. He's prepared a way for you. He does not want you to continue to live in condemnation. He does not want you to continue to live bound up by fear. He wants you to walk in boldness and courage because he has ordained your steps. Because he has taken your life and covered it with his. Because he has taken your sin and covered it by his blood. Because he sent his son. Because he loves you so much to die on the cross for you. So you don't have to carry this around anymore. It's been nailed to the cross. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we surrender those labels to you this morning. God, those things that we've identified as in our past that aren't pleasing to you, we give you those things, Lord. We give you the weight, the heaviness, the burden, the shame. Lord, we give you the painful things that we have been labeled with that weren't even our own fault, Lord. And yet we've continued to carry it around. We give those things to you, Jesus. Lord, like Rahab, we want you to use us. So God, show us how you can use our mess for your glory. Church, just raise your hands this morning and tell him, use my mess. Use my mess for your glory. God, if you can use anything, use me. I'm far from perfect, but I'm saying yes. I have a really crummy past, but I'm saying yes. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, that we're no longer identified by those things. But we are identified as a child of the one God. The God. The maker of heavens and earth. The one who loved us so much that he died for us. The King of kings and Lord of lords. The healer, provider, protector, friend. Lord, remind us of our identity in you. That we are chosen. A chosen generation and a royal priesthood. Sons and daughters of the King of Kings. That our daddy owns the cattle on a thousand hills. His provision is more than enough for me. Remind us, God, that we are perfectly and wonderfully made. Remind us, Lord, that you take our sin and cast it afar away from you as the east is from the west. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Life, you have been faithful. So my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing the goodness of God.
Come on, sing it this morning.
So my life you have been faithful. So my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing the goodness of God. So my my life, you have been faithful. So my life, you have been so, so good. 'Cause every breath that I am able, I will see the goodness of God.
Church, this morning, whether you have things you're needing to give to Jesus or you've already given them to him and you're walking in that freedom, I want to remind you this morning that as you go out the doors, you're not to go weakly. You're not to go quietly. You're to go boldly and courageously because the Lord your God goes with you wherever you go because he's prepared the path before you. So you go to your jobs boldly and courageously. You go to your schools boldly and courageously. You go into the supermarket boldly and courageously, looking for opportunities to share the good news of Jesus. Because what he's done in you, he wants to do through you. Before you go this morning, I'd like to pray a blessing over you. Would you just raise your hands with me? God, thank you for your presence here this morning. Thank you that you've come and spoken to us. Lord, don't let us leave without our hearts being changed. I ask that you would bless each and every individual under the sound of my voice, both here and online, that you would bless them and keep them, that your face would shine upon them, that you would be gracious to them, that you would grant them favor and peace. Love you, Jesus. Go with them as they go. In your name I pray. Amen and amen. We love you guys. You have a great week this week. We love you.
Hey, good morning, North Pole Assembly of God. It's been great having you with us today. Hope you enjoyed the service. Just a reminder, there's a couple different ways you can give. You can give online at northpoleag.org. Or you can give by mail, North Pole Assembly of God, 503 Kidd Boulevard, 99705. We're praying for you. We hope you have a great week. God bless you.